In a Hollow of the Hills. By Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 5. Chapter 1. It was very dark, and the wind was increasing. The last gust had been preceded by an ominous roaring down the whole mountainside, which continued for some time after the trees in the little valley had lapsed into silence. The air was filled with a faint, cool, sodden odor, as of stirred forest depths. In those intervals of silence the darkness seemed to increase in proportion and grow almost palpable. Yet out of this sightless and soundless void now came the tinkle of a spur's rowels, the dry crackling of saddle leathers, and the muffled plunge of a hoof in the thick carpet of dust and desiccated leaves. Then a voice, which in spite of its matter-of-fact reality the obscurity lent a certain mystery to, said, "I can't make out anything. Where the devil have we got to, anyway? It's as black as Tophet, here ahead." "Strike a light and make a flare with something," returned a second voice. "Look where you're shoving to now, keep your horse off, will yet." There was more muffled plunging, a silence, the rustle of paper, the quick spurt of a match, and then the uplifting of a flickering flame. But it revealed only the heads and shoulders of three horsemen, framed within a nebulous ring of light, that still left their horses and even their lower figures in impenetrable shadow. Then the flame leaped up and died out with a few zigzagging sparks that were falling to the ground, when a third voice, that was low but somewhat pleasant in its cadence, said, "Be careful where you throw that. You were careless last time. With this wind and the leaves like tinder, you might send a furnace blast through the woods. Then at least we'd see where we were." Nevertheless, he moved his horse, whose trampling hoofs beat out the last fallen spark. Complete darkness and silence again followed. Presently the first speaker continued, "I reckon we'll have to wait here till the next squall clears away the scud from the sky. Hello! What's that?" Out of the obscurity before them appeared a faint light, a dim but perfectly defined square of radiance which, however, did not appear to illuminate anything around it. Suddenly it disappeared. "That's a house, it's a light in a window," said the second voice. "House BDD," retorted the first speaker. "A house with a window on Galloper's Ridge, 15 miles from anywhere? You're crazy." Nevertheless, from the muffled plunging and tinkling that followed, they seemed to be moving in the direction where the light had appeared. Then there was a pause. "There's nothing but a rocky outcrop here, where a house couldn't stand, and we're off the trail again," said the first speaker impatiently. "Stop, there it is again." The same square of light appeared once more, but the horseman had evidently diverged in the darkness, for it seemed to be in a different direction. But it was more distinct, and as they gazed a shadow appeared upon its radiant surface, the profile of a human face. Then the light suddenly went out, and the face vanished with it. "It's a window, and there was someone behind it," said the second speaker emphatically. "It was a woman's face," said the pleasant voice. "Whoever it is, just hail them, so that we can get our bearings. Sing out. All together." The three voices rose in a prolonged shout, in which, however, the distinguishing quality of the pleasant voice was sustained. But there was no response from the darkness beyond. The shouting was repeated after an interval with the same result, the silence and obscurity remained unchanged. "Let's get out of this," said the first speaker angrily, "house or no house, man or woman, we're not wanted, and we'll make nothing waltzing round here." "Hush," said the second voice. "Shh. Listen." The leaves of the nearest trees were trilling audibly. Then came a sudden gust that swept the fronds of the taller ferns into their faces, and laid the thin, lithe whips of alder over their horses' flanks sharply. It was followed by the distant sea-like roaring of the mountainside. "That's a little more like it," said the first speaker joyfully. "Another blow like that and we're all right. And look. There's a lightning up over the trail we came by." There was indeed a faint glow in that direction, like the first suffusion of dawn, permitting the huge shoulder of the mountain along whose flanks they had been journeying to be distinctly seen. The sodden breath of the stirred forest depths was slightly tainted with an acrid fume. "That's the match you threw away 2 hours ago," said the pleasant voice deliberately. "It's caught the dry brush in the trail round the bend. Anyhow, it's given us our bearings, boys," said the first speaker, with satisfied accents. "We're all right now, and the wind's lifting the sky ahead there. Forward now, all together, and let's get out of this hell hole while we can." It was so much lighter that the bulk of each horseman could be seen as they moved forward together. But there was no thinning of the obscurity on either side of them. Nevertheless, the profile of the horseman with the pleasant voice seemed to be occasionally turned backward, and he suddenly checked his horse. "There's the window again," he said. "Look. There it's gone again." "Let it go and be d-d," returned the leader. "Come on." They spurred forward in silence. It was not long before the wayside trees began to dimly show spaces between them, and the ferns to give way to lower, thick-set shrubs, which in turn yielded to a velvety moss, with long quiet intervals of netted and tangled grasses. The regular fall of the horse's feet became a mere rhythmic throbbing. Then suddenly a single hoof rang out sharply on stone, and the first speaker reined in slightly. "Thank the Lord we're on the ridge now, and the rest is easy. Tell you what, though, boys, now we're all right, I don't mind saying that I didn't take no stock in that blamed corpse light down there. If there ever was a will-o'-the-wisp on a square-up mountain, that was one. It wasn't no window. Some of ye thought ye saw a face too, eh?" "Yes, and a rather pretty one," said the pleasant voice meditatively. "That's the way they'd build that sort of thing, of course. It's lucky ye had to satisfy yourself with looking. Gosh. I feel creepy yet, thinking of it. What are ye looking back for now like Lot's wife? Blamed if I don't think that face bewitched yet." "I was only thinking about that fire you started," returned the other quietly. "I don't see it now." "Well, if you did. I was wondering whether it could reach that hollow. I reckon that hollow could take care of any casual natrel fire that came boomin' along, and go to better every time. Why, I don't believe there was any fire. It was all a piece of that infernal ignis fatuus phantasmagoriana that was played upon us down there." With the laugh that followed they started forward again, relapsing into the silence of tired men at the end of a long journey. Even their few remarks were interjectional, or reminiscent of topics whose freshness had been exhausted with the day. The gaining light which seemed to come from the ground about them rather than from the still, overcast sky above, defined their individuality more distinctly. The man who had first spoken, and who seemed to be their leader, wore the virgin unshaven beard, mustache, and flowing hair of the Californian pioneer, and might have been the eldest. The second speaker was close-shaven, thin, and energetic; the third, with the pleasant voice, in height, litheness, and suppleness of figure appeared to be the youngest of the party. The trail had now become a grayish streak along the level tableland they were following, which also had the singular effect of appearing lighter than the surrounding landscape, yet of plunging into utter darkness on either side of its precipitous walls. Nevertheless, at the end of an hour the leader rose in his stirrups with a sigh of satisfaction. "There's the light in Collinson's mill. There's nothing gaudy and spectacular about that, boys, eh?" "No, sir. It's a square, honest beacon that a man can steer by. We'll be there in 20 minutes. He was pointing into the darkness below the already descending trail. Only a pioneer's eye could have detected the few pinpricks of light in the impenetrable distance, and it was a signal proof of his leadership that the others accepted it without seeing it. "It's just 10 o'clock, he continued, holding a huge silver watch to his eye. "We've wasted an hour on those blamed spooks yonder. We weren't off the trail more than 10 minutes, Uncle Dick," protested the pleasant voice. "All right, my son, go down there if you like and fetch out your Witch of Endor, but as for me, I'm going to throw myself the other side of Collinson's lights. They're good enough for me, and a blamed sight more stationary." The grade was very steep, but they took it, California fashion, at a gallop, being genuinely good riders, and using their brains as well as their spurs in the understanding of their horses, and of certain natural laws, which the more artificial riders of civilization are apt to overlook. Hence there was no hesitation or indecision communicated to the nervous creatures they best rode, who swept over crumbling stones and slippery ledges with a momentum that took away half their weight, and made a stumble or false step, or indeed anything but an actual collision, almost impossible. Closing together they avoided the latter, and holding each other well up, became one irresistible wedge-shaped mass. At times they yelled, not from consciousness nor bravado, but from the purely animal instinct of warning and to combat the breathlessness of their descent, until, reaching the level, they charged across the gravelly bed of a vanished river, and pulled up at Collinson's mill. The mill itself had long since vanished with the river, but the building that had once stood for it was used as a rude hostelry for travelers, which, however, bore no legend or invitatory sign. Those who wanted it, knew it, those who passed it by, gave it no offense. Collinson himself stood by the door, smoking a contemplative pipe. As they rode up, he disengaged himself from the doorpost listlessly, walked slowly towards them, said reflectively to the leader, "I've been thinking with you that a vote for Thompson is a vote thrown away," and prepared to lead the horses towards the water tank. He had parted with them over 12 hours before, but his air of simply renewing a recently interrupted conversation was too common a circumstance to attract their notice. They knew, and he knew, that no one else had passed that way since he had last spoken, that the same sun had swung silently above him and the unchanged landscape, and there had been no interruption nor diversion to his monotonous thought. The wilderness annihilates time and space with the grim pathos of patience. Nevertheless he smiled. "You don't seem to have got through coming down yet," he continued, as a few small boulders, loosened in their rapid descent, came more deliberately rolling and plunging after the travelers along the gravelly bottom. Then he turned away with the horses, and, after they were watered, he re-entered the house. His guests had evidently not waited for his ministration. They had already taken one or two bottles from the shelves behind a wide bar and helped themselves, and, glasses in hand, were now satisfying the more imminent cravings of hunger with biscuits from a barrel and slices of smoked herring from a box. Their equally singular host, accepting their conduct as not unusual, joined the circle they had comfortably drawn round the fireplace, and meditatively kicking a brand back at the fire, said, without looking at them, "Well." "Well," returned the leader, leaning back in his chair after carefully unloosing the buckle of his belt, but with his eyes also on the fire, "well, we prospected every yard of outcrop along the divide, and there ain't the ghost of a silver indication anywhere." "Not a smell," added the close-shaven guest, without raising his eyes. They all remained silent, looking at the fire, as if it were the one thing they had taken into their confidence. Collinson also addressed himself to the blaze as he said presently, "It allo seemed to me that there was something shiny about that ledge just round the shoulder of the spur, over the long canyon." The leader ejaculated a short laugh. "Shiny, eh, shiny. Ye think that a sign? Why, you might as well reckon that because Key's head, over there, is grey and silvery that he's got sabe and experience." As he spoke he looked towards the man with a pleasant voice. The fire shining full upon him revealed the singular fact that while his face was still young, and his mustache quite dark, his hair was perfectly grey. The object of this attention, far from being disconcerted by the comparison, added with a smile, "Or that he had any silver in his pocket." Another lapse of silence followed. The wind tore round the house and rumbled in the short, adobe chimney. "No, gentlemen," said the leader reflectively, "this sort o' thing is played out. I don't take no more stock in that cock and bull story about the lost Mexican mine. I don't catch on to that Sunday school yarn about the pious, scientific sharp who collected leaves and vegetables all over the divide, all the while he scientifically knew that the range was solid silver, only he wouldn't soil his fingers with godforsaken lucre. I ain't saying anything agin that fine spun theory that Key believes in about volcanic upheavals that set up on end argentiferous rock, but I simply say that I don't see it with the naked eye. And I reckon it's about time, boys, as the game's up, that we handed in our checks, and left the board. There was another silence around the fire, another whirl and turmoil without. There was no attempt to combat the opinions of their leader, possibly the same sense of disappointed hopes was felt by all, only they preferred to let the man of greater experience voice it. He went on. We've had our little game, boys, ever since we left Rawlins a week ago, we've had our ups and downs, we've been starved and parched, snowed up and half-drowned, shot at by road agents and horse thieves, kicked by mules and played with by grizzlies. We've had a heap o' fun, boys, for our money, but I reckon the picnic is about over. So we'll shake hands tomorrow all round and call it square, and go on our ways separately. And what do you think you'll do, Uncle Dick? Said his close-shaven companion listlessly. I'll make tracks for a square meal, a bed that a man can comfortably take off his boots and die in, and some violet-scented soap. Civilization's good enough for me. I even reckon I wouldn't mind the sound of the church-going bell if there was a theater handy, as there likely would be. But the wilderness is played out. You'll be back to it again in 6 months, Uncle Dick, retorted the other quickly. Uncle Dick did not reply. It was a peculiarity of the party that in their isolated companionship they had already exhausted discussion and argument. A silence followed, in which they all looked at the fire as if it was its turn to make a suggestion. Collinson, said the pleasant voice abruptly, who lives in the hollow this side of the divide, about 2 miles from the first spur above the big canyon. Nary soul. Are you sure? Sartin. Dar ain't no one but me betwixt Bald Top and Skinner's 25 miles. Of course, you'd know if anyone had come there lately, persisted the pleasant voice. I reckon. It ain't a week ago that I tramped the whole distance that you fellers just rode over. There ain't, said the leader deliberately, any enchanted castle or cabin that goes waltzing round the road with revolving windows and fairy princesses looking out of em. But Collinson, recognizing this as purely irrelevant humor, with possibly a trap or pitfall in it, moved away from the fireplace without a word, and retired to the adjoining kitchen to prepare supper. Presently he reappeared. The pork bar l's empty, boys, so I'll heave to fix ye up with jerked beef, potatoes, and flapjacks. Yes, see, dar ain't anybody been over from Skinner's store for a week. All right, only hurry up, said Uncle Dick cheerfully, settling himself back in his chair. I reckon to turn in as soon as I've wrestled with your hash, for I've got to turn out agin and be off at sunup. They were all very quiet again, so quiet that they could not help noticing that the sound of Collinson's preparations for their supper had ceased too. Uncle Dick arose softly and walked to the kitchen door. Collinson was sitting before a small kitchen stove, with a fork in his hand, gazing abstractedly before him. At the sound of his guest's footsteps he started, and the noise of preparation recommenced. Uncle Dick returned to his chair by the fire. Leaning towards the chair of the close-shaven man, he said in a lower voice. He was off agin.
What?
Thinking of that wife of his.
What about his wife? Asked Key, lowering his voice also.
The three men's heads were close together. When Collinson fixed up this mill he sent for his wife in the States, said Uncle Dick, in a half-whisper, waited a year for her, hanging round and boarding every emigrant wagon that came through the pass. She didn't come only the news that she was dead. He paused and nudged his chair still closer, the heads were almost touching. They say, over in the bar his voice had sunk to a complete whisper, that it was a lie. That she ran away with the man that was fetching her out. 3,000 miles and 3 weeks with another man upsets some women. But he knows nothing about it, only he sometimes kinder goes off loony-like, thinking of her. He stopped, the head separated. Collinson had appeared at the doorway, his melancholy patience apparently unchanged. Grubs on, gentlemen, sit by and eat. The humble meal was dispatched with zest and silence. A few interjectional remarks about the uncertainties of prospecting only accented the other pauses.
In 10 minutes they were out again by the fireplace with their lit pipes. As there were only 3 chairs, Collinson stood beside the chimney. "Collinson," said Uncle Dick, after the usual pause, taking his pipe from his lips, "as we've got to get up and get at sun up, we might as well tell you now that we're dead broke. We've been living for the last few weeks on Preble Key's loose change and that's gone. You'll have to let this little account and damage stand over." Collinson's brow slightly contracted, without, however, altering his general expression of resigned patience. "I'm sorry for you, boys," he said slowly, and, diffidently, "kinder sorry for myself, too. You see, I reckoned on going over to Skinner's tomorrow, to fill up the pork bar L and vote for Messick and the wagon road. But Skinner can't let me have anything more until I've paid Suthin on account, as he calls it. D'ye mean to say thar's any mountain man as low-flung and mean as that?" said Uncle Dick indignantly. "But it isn't his fault," said Collinson gently. "You see, they won't send him goods from Sacramento if he don't pay up, and he can't if I don't. Sabe? Ah, that's another thing. They are mean in Sacramento," said Uncle Dick, somewhat mollified. The other guests murmured an assent to this general proposition. Suddenly Uncle Dick's face brightened. "Look here. I know Skinner, and I'll stop there no, blank it all. I can't, for it's off my route. Well, then, we'll fix it this way. Key will go there and tell Skinner that I say that I'll send the money to that Sacramento hound. That'll fix it." Collinson's brow cleared, the solution of the difficulty seemed to satisfy everybody, and the close-shaven man smiled. "And I'll secure it," he said, "and give Collinson a sight draft on myself at San Francisco." "What's that for?" said Collinson, with a sudden suffusion on each cheek. "In case of accident." "What accident?" persisted Collinson, with a dark look of suspicion on his usually placid face. "In case we should forget it," said the close-shaven man, with a laugh. "And do you suppose that if you boys went and forgot it that I'd have anything to do with your DD paper?" said Collinson, a murky cloud coming into his eyes. "Why, that's only business, Collie," interposed Uncle Dick quickly. "That's all Jim Parker means, he's a businessman, don't you see? Suppose we got killed. You've that draft to show."
"Show who?" growled Collinson.
"Why hang it, our friends, our heirs, our relations to get your money," hesitated Uncle Dick. "And do you calculate," said Collinson, with deeply laboring breath, "that if you got killed, that I'd be coming on your folks for the worth of the DD truck I give ye? Go away. Lemme get out o' this. You're making me tired." He stalked to the door, lit his pipe, and began to walk up and down the gravelly riverbed. Uncle Dick followed him. From time to time the two other guests heard the sounds of alternate protest and explanation as they passed and repassed the windows. Preble Key smiled, Parker shrugged his shoulders. "He'll be thinking you've begrudged him your grub if you don't. That's the way with these businessmen," said Uncle Dick's voice in one of these intervals. Presently they re-entered the house, Uncle Dick saying casually to Parker, "You can leave that draft on the bar when you're ready to go tomorrow," and the incident was presumed to have ended. But Collinson did not glance in the direction of Parker for the rest of the evening, and, indeed, standing with his back to the chimney, more than once fell into that stolid abstraction which was supposed to be the contemplation of his absent wife. From this silence, which became infectious, the three guests were suddenly aroused by a furious clattering down the steep descent of the mountain, along the trail they had just ridden. It came near, increasing in sound, until it even seemed to scatter the fine gravel of the riverbed against the sides of the house, and then passed in a gust of wind that shook the roof and roared in the chimney. With one common impulse the three travelers rose and went to the door. They opened it to a blackness that seemed to stand as another and an iron door before them, but to nothing else. "Somebody went by then," said Uncle Dick, turning to Collinson. "Didn't you hear it?" "Nary," said Collinson patiently, without moving from the chimney. What in God's name was it, then? Only some of them boulders you loosed coming down. It's touch and go with them for days after. When I first came here I used to start up and rush out into the road like as you would yellin' and screechin' after folks that never was there and never went by. Then it got kinder monotonous, and I'd lie still and let em slide. Why, one night I'd ace sworn that someone pulled up with a yell and shook the door. But I sort of allowed to myself that whatever it wasn't wantin' to eat, drink, sleep, or it would come in, and I hadn't any call to interfere. And in the mornin' I found a rock as big as that box, lying chock-a-block-age in the door. Then I knowed I was right. Preble Key remained looking from the door. There's a glow in the sky over Big Canyon, he said, with a meaning glance at Uncle Dick. Saw it an hour ago, said Collinson. It must be the woods afire just round the bend above the canyon. Whoever goes to Skinner's had better give it a wide berth. Key turned towards Collinson as if to speak, but apparently changed his mind, and presently joined his companions, who were already rolling themselves in their blankets, in a series of wooden bunks or berths, ranged as in a ship's cabin, around the walls of a razy-noose, sawdusty apartment that had been the measuring room of the mill. Collinson disappeared, no one knew or seemed to care where, and, in less than 10 minutes from the time that they had returned from the door, the hush of sleep and rest seemed to possess the whole house. There was no light but that of the fire in the front room, which threw flickering and gigantic shadows on the walls of the three empty chairs before it. An hour later it seemed as if one of the chairs were occupied, and a grotesque profile of Collinson's slumbering or meditating face and figure was projected grimly on the rafters as though it were the hovering guardian spirit of the house. But even that passed presently and faded out, and the beleaguering darkness that had encompassed the house all the evening began to slowly creep in through every chink and cranny of the rambling, ill-jointed structure, until it at last obliterated even the faint embers on the hearth. The cool fragrance of the woodland depths crept in with it until the steep of human warmth, the reek of human clothing, and the lingering odors of stale human victual were swept away in that incorruptible and omnipotent breath. An hour later and the wilderness had repossessed itself of all. Key, the lightest sleeper, awoke early, so early that the dawn announced itself only in two dim squares of light that seemed to grow out of the darkness at the end of the room where the windows looked out upon the valley. This reminded him of his woodland vision of the night before, and he lay and watched them until they brightened and began to outline the figures of his still sleeping companions. But there were faint stirrings elsewhere, the soft brushing of a squirrel across the shingled roof, the tiny flutter of invisible wings in the rafters, the peep and squeak of baby life below the floor. And then he fell into a deeper sleep, and awoke only when it was broad day. The sun was shining upon the empty bunks, his companions were already up and gone. They had separated as they had come together with the light-hearted irresponsibility of animals without regret, and scarcely reminiscence, bearing, with cheerful philosophy and the hopefulness of a future unfettered by their past, the final disappointment of their quest. If they ever met again, they would laugh and remember, if they did not, they would forget without a sigh. He hurriedly dressed himself, and went outside to dip his face and hands in the bucket that stood beside the door, but the clear air, the dazzling sunshine, and the unexpected prospect half intoxicated him. The abandoned mill stretched beside him in all the pathos of its premature decay. The ribs of the water wheel appeared amid a tangle of shrubs and driftwood, and were twined with long grasses and straggling vines, mounds of sawdust and heaps of brush had taken upon themselves a velvety moss where the trickling slime of the vanished river lost itself in sluggish pools, discolored with the dyes of redwood. But on the other side of the rocky ledge dropped the whole length of the valley, alternately bathed in sunshine or hidden in drifts of white and clinging smoke. The upper end of the long canyon, and the crests of the ridge above him, were lost in this fleecy cloud, which at times seemed to overflow the summits and fall in slow leaps like lazy cataracts down the mountainside. Only the range before the ledge was clear, there the green pines seemed to swell onward and upward in long mounting billows, until at last they broke against the sky. In the keen stimulus of the hour and the air, Key felt the mountaineer's longing for action, and scarcely noticed that Collinson had pathetically brought out his pork barrel to scrape together a few remnants for his last meal. It was not until he had finished his coffee, and Collinson had brought up his horse, that a slight sense of shame at his own and his comrade's selfishness embarrassed his parting with his patient host. He himself was going to Skinner's to plead for him. He knew that Parker had left the draft he had seen it lying in the bar, but a new sense of delicacy kept him from alluding to it now. It was better to leave Collinson with his own peculiar ideas of the responsibilities of hospitality unchanged. He shook his hand warmly, and galloped up the rocky slope. But when he had finally reached the higher level, and fancied he could even now see the dust raised by his departing comrades on their two diverging paths, although he knew that they had already gone their different ways perhaps never to meet again, his thoughts and his eyes reverted only to the ruined mill below him and its lonely occupant. He could see him quite distinctly in that clear air, still standing before his door. And then he appeared to make a parting gesture with his hand, and something like snow fluttered in the air above his head. It was only the torn fragments of Parker's draft, which this homely gentleman of the Sierras, standing beside his empty pork barrel, had scattered to the four winds.